Part of my theme here is part of his lament. I call it lament. I mean, I've never seen anybody else that could call it his lament. That line, it's not easy, Bein green.
Hope I didn't hurt his feelings.
It's not easy being green, having to spend each day the color of the leaves. When I think it might be nicer being red or yellow or gold or something much more colorful like that. It's not easy being green. Seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things, and people tend to pass you over because you're not standing out like flashy sparkles in the water or stars in the sky. But green's the color of spring, and green can be cool and friendly like. And green can be big, like a mountain, or important, like a river, or tall, like a tree. When green is all there is to be, it could make you wonder why. But why wonder? Why wonder? I'm green, and it'll do fine. It's beautiful, and I think it's what I wanna be.
Okay, so, but hopefully you kind of get the message there, but I'll kind of revisit that with you. Kermit said I had to make sure you walked away with that message. So I guess the first part is too, I just want to get your sense. I asked one question already. What is your sense? Everybody here knows what plants are, right? So we just had this spiel about Kermit. Everybody knows what plants are. What are plants? Give me examples of plants. Grass, trees, oak trees, palm trees, all kinds of stuff, right? Everybody knows what plants are, right? They tend to blend in, though, like Kermit said, right? So these are all some of the plants you might have, on the property here or in your houses. And what are animals? Everybody knows what an animal is, right, too, right? What are animals? Give me examples of animals. So what's the difference between plants and animals? What makes them different? One has legs. Which one? Trees? You ever see those mangroves? No. Chlorophyll. Okay. Well, basically, plants make their own food. Animals need to consume. Most plants are stationary. Most animals are mobile, but that's not really true. So fundamentally, what plants do, though, on our Earth, is they basically take light and make life. And once that life is out there, that's what feeds and in most cases provides shelter for animals. So that's a fundamental difference. Most people who speak here to you, they're biologists, study animals. I'm one of the few that studies the plant side of thing. So When I started teaching about 20 years ago, I was teaching a class. It was a class on marine plants. And I stumbled upon this quote, plants are the most important, least understood, and most taken for granted of all living things. And I really, the more I thought about that, so anytime I teach a class and it's got plants in it, that's one of the very first things I tell, you know, the students. And I ask them to think about that a little bit, because just like yourselves, most of them don't have a lot of plant background. You know, there's some exceptions. I know some of you do have good plant background as well. And really, that's what Kermit's saying, too. He's basically saying, you blend in with everything. People tend to pass over. You know, you're not fireworks. You know, you're not stars in the sky, and so on. And then after I was teaching about 10 years, I also added to the students, you know, the more I thought about that first sentence up there, it's even more true for plants that live under the water, because we can't see them at all. So all the other ones, you pass them by, but, you know, they're in your vision. You know, they're in your everyday experience. But when I talk to you tonight, most people really haven't seen seagrasses all that much. How many of you have actually gone out specifically in the Indian River Lagoon looking for seagrasses? More people than I thought. This is very good. All right. We're doing good. So you can tell me then, what are seagrasses? What are seagrasses?
Plants
that live under the water. And specifically, we call them angiosperms because they're flowering plants. Angiosperms is just a fancy word for flowering plants. So the same thing that you know of roses and hibiscuses and grass and, you know, everything that's on land that flowers. So these are flowering plants that have adapted to living in the marine environment. Why are they important? They're important, as I've already alluded to, the fact that they're highly productive. They make a lot of food for other organisms. Some of that food is eaten directly. For example, manatees directly consume seagrasses. They also provide a lot of habitat out in the marine world, or really any environment that we have in nature. The more structure that you put out, like a rainforest or a coral reef or a seagrass bed, the more opportunity you have for other organisms, most of which are animals, to find a home. Besides the herbivores, which is things that eat the plants, also they go into detritus. Detritus is dead stuff, right? But there's a lot of organisms that depend upon that dead stuff. And what happens is there's a group of microbes, a whole range of microbes that will actually grow on that dying material or dead material, and they change it. They change the nutritional value of it, and then there's other animals that can come in and then eat that. So they may not eat the living plant material, but they'll eat the dead stuff. They're very important in terms of cycling nutrients, so like nitrogen and phosphorus. We'll talk a little bit about nutrients in a little bit. And also, they're very important in stabilizing sediments. So for example, after the hurricanes, you know, there was a lot of movement of spoil islands. There was a lot of erosion on the land. There was some damage to seagrass beds, but not really very much. They kind of held their own positions. And most of the soil and sediments that moved around was actually where was unvegetated. So one of the things that plants do is also stabilize the environment, like mangroves along shorelines. I've used the expression a lot, as have some other people, about the Indian River Lagoon being an estuary in transition. A lot of you are interested in the lagoon. Seagrass is obviously a big part of that. One could argue that the lagoon has always been in transition since it started. It's the nature of a lagoon. It's the nature of an estuary. And but all other people have pointed out that maybe it's undergoing a lot of rapid changes now, maybe a lot more rapid than it has in the past. So I do also want to orient you to the Indian River Lagoon. For those of you who may not be familiar with it, it occupies about 40% of the east coast of Florida, and it goes all the way down to Jupiter Inlet. So it's a good hour's drive from here by interstate, and it goes up past Cape Canaveral and includes Mosquito Lagoon. It goes all the way up here to Ponce de Leon Inlet. So Daytona is just up here somewhere. So that's a very large part of our coastline. In fact, it is one of the largest systems like that in our country. And it has a lot of life, a lot of diversity. Diversity basically is life. Numbers of different types of organisms. This was first really worked out. There was one person that I would give the most credit to. It's Grant Gilmore, who was a fish biologist. He's still working in the area. Grant worked here about 28 years. And I think he's found 660 species that live in the Indian River Lagoon and the reefs just offshore, you know, out to maybe the Gulf Stream or the Florida Current. The federal government, through the EPA National Estuarine Program, has recognized the Indian River Lagoon as an estuary of national significance. So beyond the fact that it's our backyard, it's also very important at a national level, primarily for this biodiversity, these number of organisms. Why is there so many different organisms in the lagoon? It's a very skinny, shallow system, but it gets things from the north that are more, we'd say, temperate, a little more cool water tolerant. Gets things from the south, from the tropical areas, and they kind of converge. And these inlets are very important passages that exchange and connect these different systems. Grant, in particular, has identified the southern part of the lagoon as being the original hotspot in the lagoon. That's really where a lot of the work started to say the Indian River Lagoon is really special. Perhaps you're more interested in the economic impact, and you wonder, well, what might that be? In 2007 and 2008, the National Estuarine Program did a study. They commissioned a study, and it's about $4 billion a year to the state of Florida. So that's a very significant economic driver in our region. Most of that is, everyday folks. A lot of you raised your hand going out and say you went out for seagrasses. I suspect a lot of you have also gone out for fish. And a lot of this is driven by sports fishing. About $1 billion of that is fisheries. About 90% of that $1 billion is by sport fishermen. Commercial fishing is not all that much of a component here. It's the average person on the street who's going out and spending money on bait and boats and all the other things that you do when you have a good day fishing. Most of you know, too, that we've changed the land here a lot through time, especially over about the last 80 years or so. The watershed and how we drain our land has been altered, and there's a lot more freshwater outflow going into the lagoon. The lagoon is only about 5.5 feet deep on average, so it's very shallow. Okay, so I could stand up most of the lagoon. The distance to the inlets is a really important thing when you start to talk about understanding certain patterns like nutrient and some of the blooms we may be talking about. In our area, down near Harbor Branch, Vero Beach, this area, the average drop of water that might be in Vero Beach today, it takes about 5 to 7 days to go out the Fort Pierce Inlet. That's pretty fast. A drop of water up here in the northern part of the lagoon, or Mosquito Lagoon, because they're so far away to the inlets. The next one is way down here in Sebastian, way up here, Ponce de Leon. It's on the order of a year. Ned Smith, who's in the audience, has done a lot of this work. So if you ever want to know about water circulation or just about anything to do with the lagoon on the physical side, Ned's the guy to talk to. He's made a lot of good contributions here. You all know there's lots of issues with the lagoon because of mostly freshwater discharges. And I'm going to talk about some of these later. And you've heard in some of the other talks in the series last year, and you'll hear in the upcoming series in 2013, more about some of these others, such as marine mammal diseases. We've had a number of really good talks about that. We had a talk this past year on manatees, and we've had talks in the past on bird life, for example. I'm not going to talk about it so much because, again, I'm going to kind of come back to it. But when I was putting this talk together, one of the things I really wanted to bring out was things that you don't hear about so much anymore. If any of you heard another talk that I gave once, it was called Shifting Baselines, and kind of got into how things change through time, and we kind of forget about certain things. And so the present time is kind of a new baseline always. So some of the things that I think have been very important through time, in other words, all the problems we have now, I think that we'd have them much sooner, or they'd be much worse, if we didn't have some things that were really good success stories in the past. One of them was the reconnection of impounded wetlands to the Indian River Lagoon. Many of you may know, and some of you I'm sure don't, that in the 1950s and 60s, basically the Indian River Lagoon was essentially diked off from the wetlands next to it. And the reason that was done, and then those wetlands were flooded, it was called impoundments, and the reason for that was to reduce the problems with salt marsh mosquitoes, which breed in moist salt water on top of sediment. So it's a very fine layer. Salt marsh mosquitoes actually don't cause any diseases, but they are pretty pesky, as I'm sure some of you know, or most of you know. And so it seemed like a good thing at the time. But what unfortunately they didn't realize at the time was the importance of the wetlands. And while this may sound like, well, you know, it may sound like they should have known better. I'm not sure that that's the case because, for example, it wasn't until the 1970s that one of the Odoms working in University of Miami for his PhD, that was the first time in the early 1970s that people really understood that, hey, mangroves might be important. Previously, the thought was these were swamps, these were areas that had no value to us, and so the idea of flooding them and eradicating the vegetation didn't really seem like a big issue. That same Grant Gilmore I mentioned to you earlier did some work in the early 1980s, and I remember at the time him and his group going through all the impoundments, and it's kind of ugly work in the impoundments sometimes. And one of the take-home messages of his work was that it was really important for fish and large crustaceans, crabs, and other things to move back and forth between, say, seagrasses and salt marsh or seagrasses and mangroves. So largely because of his work and a whole bunch of agencies up and down the Indian River Lagoon, most of the impoundments, about 95% of them, have been reconnected. Not fully. In most cases, it's culverts. In most cases, there still is some seasonal flooding. But if you look around, and there's some examples right on our own campus here, when we opened up impoundments, what an incredible resurgence we had. Around here, it's mangroves. To the north, it's marshes. So the productivity of the lagoon has really gone up thanks to that. A lot of us forget that until the 1990s, we discharged all of our wastewater from our sewage systems up and down the lagoon directly in the lagoon. In the early part of our civilization here, it was totally untreated. As time went on, they began to treat it, but it still had all the nutrients, the nitrogen and phosphorus that we worry about so much. So this was actually done by the state as an initiative that was done by local people here in the community. Another thing that happened in the 90s that was very controversial at the time was banning of gill nets. Gill nets are basically nets that hang out in the water, and it gills all the fish that come through it. So it basically harvests every single fish that passes by that net. Only a fraction of them are the target species. The rest of it is disposed of. It's waste. It's thrown back in. We call that bycatch. And that was a very destructive thing. And it was very controversial, as I said, but it led to a lot of good things. And I think if you talk to most sports fishermen, they will tell you that after a couple of years, there was quite an increase in the fishes they were catching. Another good thing about this is it led to a lot of aquaculture programs in the state, and Harbor Branch was part of that. Initially, it was to help the displaced fishermen to kind of continue to have a career, you know, working in marine fisheries. It was just a different type of fishery. So again, that happened a while ago, so we tend to forget about some of this. And there's also been a lot of local efforts to improve water quality, and I could mention a few of those in Indian River County. And particularly, but they all have to do with using marshes to filter out some of the nutrients that come out of the discharge canals. I'll be talking about the discharge canals in a few minutes. So, long story short is for seagrasses is that seagrasses is the basis for a major regional economy by providing that productivity and nursery habitat for fisheries. For the last 20 years, all of the agencies that work in the lagoon and basically all the estuaries in Florida recognize that the best way to manage the lagoon is to manage for seagrasses. When seagrasses are doing well, other things are doing well. I always say healthy seagrass equals more fish. A lot more people, you know, are interested in having more fish. People have estimated what the value of the seagrass would be based on that fishery commodity. And the numbers range from about $10,000 to $20,000 an acre. So I put a smaller value here, $10,000 an acre per year. If you compare that, say, to good old Iowa corn crop, that's higher than most agriculture, okay? And we're not putting any of our energy into it. That's just nature using sunlight and cycling energy and nutrients through it. Oops, I gotta get rid of this. So I want to briefly tell you about some of the seagrasses that are found in the Indian River Lagoon for a quick tutorial. We have a total of how many species in the lagoon? Anybody know?
Seven.
Excellent. You're well prepared. Seven species. And that doesn't sound like a lot maybe to some folks, but it's actually more than anywhere else in North America. There's no place that has more seagrasses than here. And the one that you see if you go out anywhere and find seagrass, the one that's always going to be there if you have seagrass is this one. It's called shoalgrass or halidule. It's a very skinny, flat blade. And, you know, the canopy height on this is typically just about 6 inches. So it's not huge. Manatee grass or syringodium has got rounded blades, and it's about twice the size. So you can easily tell it mainly because of its roundedness, and I always kind of feel it. And if I can't see it, I can do it in the dark. Just feel if it's rounded or flat. And this one is found through the southern lagoon, and it kind of skips a large part of the lagoon, and is found in the northern lagoon. And then it goes further north out of Florida. Turtle grass or thalassia is found between up to Sebastian Inlet. Does not go any further north than that. That's its northern limit along this part of the United States. This is the grass that is the grass that's most dominant further south in the Caribbean. If you go down to the Keys, jump in the water anywhere there's seagrass, it's going to be this one, thalassia. It's got a tall canopy also, and it's flat, but it's a wide blade. So it's, again, very easy to tell compared to the other ones. Those of you who are from up north and know eelgrass, it looks a lot like eelgrass or zostera. Then we have rupia. Rupia is also called widgeon grass. And it looks a little bit like halidule, but it has branches. The shoot, the upright's actually a branch. And it's found usually where there's some more fresh water. And it is something that oftentimes attracts waterfowl or water birds. Then we have three species of Halophila, and that's kind of special. This is Halophila engelmannii, and it has these whorls, which basically are when leaves all come out one place. That's a whorl of leaves. It's called star grass. It's very small, only about 2 inches high. So these are small plants. Then there's two others that look a lot alike. Halophila decipiens, or paddle grass. Halophila johnsonii, or Johnson's grass. And Johnson's grass was described around 1980 by somebody who worked here. It wasn't me. It's named for our founder, Seward Johnson Sr., same person who this building is named for. This species is why we have more seagrasses here than anywhere else in the area. It grows up to Sebastian Inlet and grows as far south as northern Biscayne Bay. In the 1990s, some of the local agency folks got together and made a request to the federal government to put this on the threatened and endangered species list. So it's actually listed as a threatened species. It's the only seagrass anywhere in the world that has that special status. And the reason it has that is because it's very limited distribution, like I just talked about. And also, remember, these are flowering plants. So that means they have male, they have female. This one doesn't. This one has never been found to have male plants. Only females, no seeds. So it doesn't reproduce sexually. Theoretically, it's all asexual or vegetative propagation. And that's why that has that extra protected status. Maybe someday, and people have looked for decades, maybe someday they'll find a male plant out here or a seed, but it doesn't seem very likely at this point. A lot of interesting questions could come up about that particular plant. There's lots of challenges. First of all, very few flowering plants can live in marine environments. Do you know how many flowering plants there are in the world? Anybody have an idea? How many species have been described? About 250,000. About 0.04%, about 100 of those are seagrasses. So about 0.04% of all the possible plants that might be angiosperms living in marine environments, it's a very tiny percentage of them. It's a very harsh place to live. Those of you who've been out in lagoon, you know the sediments below just a very superficial layer are very nasty. They're toxic to a lot of things that need oxygen because it's an anaerobic environment. There's a lot of hydrogen sulfide. So seagrasses have quite a challenge. They have roots below the sediment, and they have to produce a lot of oxygen, and they pump that down into the roots. The roots are basically acting like animals down there. They're not making food. They're basically, you know, using food from the photosynthetic part that's above the sediments. So that means that compared to most plants, these have a very high light requirement. So if you want to understand seagrasses, and when you find seagrasses are dying in the lagoon, one of the very first things you should think about is light. And this is happy seagrass up here. Happy seagrass, you know, gets lots of light. As you go deeper in the lagoon, you get attenuation, you know, it gets very dark. Any of you been out in the lagoon, you know, sometimes you really can't see very far in the lagoon. And most seagrasses require about 20 or 25% of full sunlight. So once you get below that for any significant period of time, you'll have loss of seagrass habitat. So we'll come back to that again. But that's one of the big challenges. Here's just another schematic that says there's lots of things in the water column that can absorb or attenuate light. These are things like suspended solids, or you might say turbidity. These are particles. And again, those of you who've been out in the lagoon know that if this cold front, for example, if the wind starts blowing from the north, and if you're out there, you'll watch the sediments just come up off the bottom, and you'll see the light reduction very fast. Also, there's a lot of other things that are coming up from those sediments when that happens. A lot of nutrients are coming up from the sediments, for example. Another attenuator is color. You know from freshwater discharges, if you live in Fort Pierce and you watch Taylor Creek, you can see that very nice sharp delineation of Taylor Creek water and Indian River Lagoon or ocean water that comes through the inlet. Lastly, a big attenuator is chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is that same pigment that you guys mentioned earlier. It's an algae as well, and it's those algae that, if they're in the water column, the phytoplankton will absorb the light before the seagrasses. So they're basically out-competing the seagrasses for that. We also have things that grow on the seagrass called epiphytes. That's what that word means, growing on plants. And those can further reduce the light available to seagrasses. So it's all about light, because remember, it's all about energy, because what plants do is they take energy and they make life out of it. You cut down how much energy they get, that's going to be less life coming out the other end. A lot of these factors that attenuate light are highly correlated with reduced salinity and freshwater inputs. I did a project in the 90s that there's this big report and it came out about 2001. I basically looked at seagrasses from about here all the way north to the Cape. And there's a lot of statistics in there and so on. And basically, we were looking at light, continuous light measurements over 2 years and looking at a lot of water quality parameters. And basically, what we found was that the biggest attenuators of light lagoon-wide were turbidity, so those particles that gets suspended in the water or discharged off of land. Color, which is a sign of freshwater discharge. That color, by the way, comes from vegetation on the freshwater side of things, so it's a natural phenomenon. It's like a lot of phenolic compounds, if you know what phenols are, and they add color to the freshwater. So you can kind of visually, you know, when you see it, you know there's freshwater intrusion. And then lastly, chlorophyll A. But by far and away, in that study, it was turbidity. The other two were a lot less significant, but they were all significant, and they all interact together. So sometimes, what about our impact, our anthropogenic or human-induced impact? Well, there's two main categories in my mind. One is physical impacts. This is prop scarring. This is in the northern part of the lagoon. So you can see a boater kind of came into a seagrass bed and kind of meandered around a while, and basically was ripping up the seagrass beds a lot. So a lot of this is mechanical damage. And you know, you might think initially, well, that's probably going to be something that could heal over pretty quick. Well, it doesn't. Thalassia, for example, might take 20 years to recover. So it's a longer term problem than you think. And if you get enough scarring, you actually start to have a lot more erosion. So you have a lot of secondary losses around the prop scars. So this is a big challenge. A lot of the concern overall in the lagoon has to do with eutrophication or nutrient pollution. So this is nitrogen and phosphorus. I already told you that we don't have sewage discharges anymore. Sewage discharge is point sources. So back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s throughout the country, that's what everybody went after was, you know, if you saw a pipe and it was putting bad things in the environment, that's what the primary focus was on, solving those problems. In retrospect, that was pretty easy. This is all non-point source. Non-point source means that, say, a canal in Vero Beach might have, you know, fertilizer from my yard. They might have oil dripped from my car as I'm driving down the road. And the rain would then wash that oil into a canal, for example. It could be some of the agricultural sources. So basically, the big challenge nowadays is that there are so many different sources of pollutants that it's very hard to go back and find a single pipe because so many of us are contributing to this. So that's the big challenge that we have today. So here's my overall model. What we do on land, how much we load, if you will, into the lagoon. This could be particles, that's those sediments. It could be nutrients. It could be anything. You name it. You can look at it if you want. But what we do on land impacts the water quality in the lagoon. And basically, when you have good water quality, and I'll explain to you a little bit what that means, it's critical for good seagrass. And the mechanism is primarily, in my mind, for seagrasses, has to do with the reduction in light. And that impacts seagrasses. And if you impact seagrass, then you impact the biodiversity and productivity of the entire system. So how does water quality affect seagrasses in the IRL, in the Indian River Lagoon? Well, seagrass presence and abundance is highly variable, and it's primarily related to water quality. Hallidooly, I said, is found just about any time you see seagrasses, you find it. So what does that tell you? It tells you it's very tolerant. It can handle low salinities. It can handle higher salinities. It can handle rapid changes, more so than the others. I mentioned rupia to you, and I said, well, you know, you usually find that more when there's a lot of fresh water. You're more likely to find that in the impoundments that have higher fresh water. When you have more stable water quality, which is lower turbidity, lower water color, for example, you then have more species and more biomass or that amount of material out there. So I mentioned some of these to you already. I said syringodium kind of is in the south, it's in the northern part of the lagoon, disappears in between. And that's believed to be because of some of the, call it urban outfalls from Vero Beach and Melbourne and those areas in very narrow parts of the lagoon. That's why we believe that some of these seagrasses disappear. Lophila jansonii, despite the fact it's on that critical species list, actually is incredibly tolerant of changes in water quality. That's kind of a surprise to a lot of people. I want to talk a little bit about current research. And if you look real carefully, you can see yourself. You're right in there. And specifically, some of the long-term monitoring work that I've been doing in my lab for about 7 years. So I've done work over the years, but this has kind of been a continuous block now that I'm talking about. I mentioned some of the earlier stuff a little while ago. A lot of my work all of my work right now really is very local. And I work in Indian River and St. Lucie counties pretty much exclusively. In Vero Beach, the issue there is that you have three relief canals, the North, Main, and South Canal. If you live in Vero Beach, we all know them very well. And they were built 100 years ago, and they had to be built because this was basically wetlands. And in order to have houses and farms and so on, we had to drain the water, and that was done. And it was done really well. So what I've been doing, but again, just like one of the things I mentioned earlier about the impoundments, is now we're starting to realize that because of all of our other activities on land, that the canals have also been a very effective way to get water, fresh water, and pollutants out into the lagoon. So I've got six stations. This one here is near Grand Harbor, if you know where Grand Harbor is. This one here is right here at Harbor Ranch. And my most southern one is getting around St. Lucie Village. So these three are my more northern stations, and they're kind of close to Vero Beach proper and near those canals. And the other three are further downstream, closer to the inlet. And I monitor a bunch of things. With some of it is done automatically with these instruments. They're called data sounds. And they have different probes that you might be able to see here. And so the things I measure are temperature, salinity, turbidity, dissolved oxygen. You know, oxygen is very important, especially for fishes, pH, how acid the water is, and also chlorophyll A. And then we take some additional weekly measurements. We have to go out, clean these up. We download the data. We take some additional information, including nutrients, which is real important, And also we calculate those light attenuation coefficients. This basically is an index of how much light's getting to the seagrass. So I'm not going to show you an awful lot of this record, but I picked one that I thought would be the one that everybody would probably relate to the most, and that's salinity. Just how salty is the Indian River Lagoon? Historically, here at Harbor Branch, the salinity out the door here is about 28 parts per thousand, but it varies a lot. And these are actually my six stations just plotted on top of each other through time every week for X number of years. And you'll see that here's the average somewhere up here, but you'll see we have these very sharp dips. And I'm sure that you know what causes all those, right? Things like Hurricane Wilma. I wasn't here, I didn't have it in for the twin storms. Had I had them in 2004, well, hopefully they would have survived, but it would have been incredible data to have gotten. I don't have that data, unfortunately. Some of you may remember Tropical Storm Fay that dumped 24 inches of rain in some places and was a serious flood to the south and to the north of us. But sometimes we have things like unusual rains in the dry season in March of 2010, for example. And on average, I thought it was interesting, on average we get this about every 2.5 years. We seem to get more worried about storms more frequently than 2.5 years. But on average, we have a major rain event connected to a storm about every 2.5 years. And there's great records on this that you can go back through time on. And I just want to give you one summary of some of the other water quality stuff. So on all my graphs, this way to me is north and this is south. So these are Vero Beach, the three Vero Beach stations. These are three to the south. So the average salinity, you can see, here to the south, which was about 32, and up in Vero Beach was about 28 or so. This period of time was actually, overall, a very dry 5 or 6 years. Most of the time, we had some sort of drought going on. That's important to remember in the future, I think. You can see, if we're interested in nitrogen, that nitrogen is much higher in Vero and relative to, say, the most southern station. If we look at the algae in the water, the highest algae is downstream of Vero Beach, kind of increases as you go through Vero Beach, and then kind of declines again as you go down closer to the inlet. Water color, which you would expect to be kind of related to salinity, when you have low salinities, you have high water color. As salinity increases, you can see water color decreases drastically. Phosphorus is just like nitrogen. It goes down as you go further away from Vero Beach. And what I'm interested in as a plant guy, or seagrass guy, light attenuation coefficient. Higher numbers mean more light's being taken up through the water column, less light for seagrasses. And you can see that these three stations have a much higher attenuation, so less light available for seagrasses than the three stations to the south. So that's what I want to tell you a little bit about the background for water quality. I want to say that Brian LaPointe is leading a project. I'm involved with it as well, but he's looking up and down the lagoon at about 20 stations, and he's using another tool, stable isotopes, which basically will tell us, for example, is it more likely nitrogen is coming from fertilizer or nitrogen is coming from a septic tank? And in about a year, we should have a really good story. He's got a preliminary story now, but in about a year, we should have a really good story. And over these years, I've been taking seaweed samples right here, and I'm going to do the exact same thing over our local community. So I should have a much better idea what's going on in terms of the possible source of nitrogen in the area. So what about the seagrasses? Well, remember I said Vero Beach had very high light attenuation, so less light, and the other three stations had a lot more light availability. This is length of seagrass beds. Up and down the lagoon, there's a lagoon-wide monitoring system that is managed by the St. John's River Water Management District for about 20 years. I was involved when it first got started, some of the original stations. And length of seagrass beds basically is just how big is it from shore out to the deepest point. So it's a very good indicator, very quick and dirty. Any of us could go out and do that. And what you find is that in Vero Beach, they're very short, about 100 meters long. As you go further south, they're 400 to 600 meters long. So substantially long, you know, bigger seagrass resource as you go away from Vero Beach. And you can also see that it doesn't change very much. It changes hardly at all down around where we are. If you look very carefully, and I agree this doesn't show this very well because there's so much data here, but you'll see that the last 2 years in Vero Beach, there's been a very significant decline, which we'll get to. So just flashing back on that, really what I want to key in is the seagrasses are basically telling you what's going on with light. So then our challenge is to figure out from these other water quality parameters which of those are responsible for the light attenuation. So that's what I did a number of years ago at a bunch of stations up and down Lagoon, but we're doing that in earnest in the local waters. So we're basically interested in these three stations versus those three. Also, if we look at the relative abundance, I told you there are different types of seagrasses, and I said some of them were pretty tolerant. I said Haldouli was the most tolerant one. These are the seagrass beds in Vero Beach area. They're heavily Haldouli with just traces of other species. If you go further south, you see a lot more Syringodium or Thalassia. Thalassia starts to increase. So I said earlier, those are ones that are a lot more tolerant, but those are also the ones that probably have better habitat value. So basically, the relationship between water quality and seagrasses is fairly complicated, but you can reduce it to the fact that when you have better water quality, more stable water quality, you'll have more seagrass resource. And if you have more seagrass resource, you're going to have more animal resources. Now I want to take a step back and look at the whole lagoon for a minute. And this is not my work. This is work from that long-term monitoring program, the St. John's River Water Management District. And they actually got aerial photographs back from 1943. Why in the world do we have aerial photographs from 1943? Military, right? We had a lot of military training going on. We have tremendous imagery of the Indian River Lagoon and a lot of other areas in Florida. So if you're ever interested in history, go back and take a look at some of these old pictures. They estimated about 25,000 hectares. A hectare is 2.5 acres. And then these are basically this transect length that I mentioned to you. Sorry, the bars here are their estimated cover from aerial flyovers. So on average, about every 2 years, they take aerial photographs. And then they go out and have people ground truth what's out there, and they estimate the cover. This line here shows you the long-term average over a couple of decades. And the story was, here it was about 20,000 acres. Here it's about 30,000 acres. That's a 50% increase in seagrass. If I'd given this talk 2 years ago, I would have said seagrasses are doing really well. Now, a lot of people didn't say that 2 years ago. But these are the data from throughout the Indian River Lagoon. This is the transect length data, very similar to what I showed you. And again, it shows a significant increase, from the 90s, early 90s, to 2010. So that's a real interesting data set. 2011 came along, and here's what happened in 2011. Everything on this side is a deficit, as you can see by the color. Everything over here is a positive. This is from north to south. So here's the actual all the stations they got. You see they got really good coverage. And Harbor Branch is right about here. So everything to the north of us basically lost very significant seagrasses. In some cases, this line here is 100% loss. So all the seagrasses were lost in 1 year at a lot of stations. Okay. Around us, Vero Beach area, Harbor Branch area, some losses, not huge. Really interesting to me is if you go further south of Fort Pierce Inlet, seagrasses have increased in that 1 year, and in some cases rather substantially. You know, would anybody have thought that? This is the value of long-term monitoring. What caused that drop, I'm sure you've heard, is an algal bloom, at least the northern part of the lagoon. It's been called the super bloom of 2011. And we call it that because if you look through there's at least 30 years of good records on chlorophyll, you know, how much chlorophyll is in the water column. And this is far higher than anything that has ever been seen. It's a species that has never been seen in the lagoon before. It's called resaltor. And I see Paul Hargraves in the audience, and he's the microalgal expert, so you can ask him all the questions you want about this one, and especially the next one I'm going to show. But it's a small green flagellate. This is a little flagellum, for those of you who are into flagellum, just one. It had up to 800 million cells per liter, and it started in the Northern Lagoon in April of 2011. And then that's when the seagrass decline started. And it went through the fall, and then it dissipated last fall, and we thought, okay, well, that's done. Hopefully it's a one-time thing. It's not going to come back again. A lot of us thought, well, maybe this would reoccur the following year. It wasn't what reoccurred the following year. Instead, we had a different algal bloom, again to the north, northern part of the lagoon, and the mosquito lagoon, called, and this one's called the brown tide, and it's tentatively identified, and Paul can say this so much better than I. Paul, how do you say that, really? And he's one of the people who actually first described it, right, many years ago, 1985 or so? 89. So he actually was one of the authors who first described this. And and it had 3 billion cells per liter. Again, very, very tiny flagellate. You can see how it changes the water. And you can imagine there's no light getting through there to speak of. I think what's more disturbing about this, and you know, if you know me, I don't really say be disturbed or, you know, this is a big problem. This really concerns me because this is the same species that when it bloomed for 8 years in a row in the 1990s in the the Laguna Madre in Texas, resulted in very serious long-term impacts on seagrasses and other resources. So these last 2 years have been very challenging for seagrasses when we talk about challenging. So, a bunch of people are working on this problem. It's headed by the St. John's River Water Management District. They are the people that are the lead agency for the lagoon. Basically, most lagoon management is with the water management districts. The border between South Florida Water Management District and St. John's is the same border between, it's a couple miles up the road here, between Indian River County and St. Lucie County. So my study actually straddles both of those districts. And you can see some of the institutions, myself, and actually, I don't know if Nikki's here tonight, but Nikki Dix, who's a postdoc here, working on plankton, because I think a big part of the story here is, you know, this is a plankton story. We've been looking at seagrass, and here we have a plankton story, plankton challenge. Some of the things we're trying to do is basically get everybody to work together, which hasn't happened enough in the lagoon, try to really understand all of the information that we might have. When these things happen, they're very unplanned, and you really can't go back through time and get more nutrient data. If you didn't have it, you don't have it. But you still have to find it, and you still have to try to cross-correlate an awful lot of information. Ultimately, we're trying to come up with cause and effect hypotheses that could be tested, and we're going to come up with a paper that's due out probably early next year that will say here's what we think, or here's what we hypothesize was the trigger, and here's how we might try to determine that and what we could do about it. So that's been a very interesting exercise I've been involved. Here's the model. Now, in the next hour, I'm going to go through this with you. Okay. But this just goes to show you. I only show this to let you know that, you know, sometimes you'll read three lines that somebody may have written somewhere, and it's really, you know, a lot more complicated than that. And the thing is, nowadays, we have computers and we have modeling capability where we might be able to come up with, like I said, testable hypotheses. I want to mention very briefly where we're going at Harbor Branch with the Indian River Lagoon. Some of you may have gotten, you can go to our website and see that recently we came up with a strategic plan for Harbor Branch. Here's some of the key pieces of it. Exploration and discovery, marine ecosystem health, which sounds familiar based on my talk. Wise use of marine resources, and so on. These are themes that we've actually had probably over the years. Maybe we never said it this way. Maybe we never really integrated it this way or the way we're going to do it in the future. And technology, of course, in the oceans is a real important theme. So I'm not really going to talk about that very much. What I want you to know is that in that research plan, there's something highlighted for the Indian River Lagoon, which is the Indian River Lagoon Observatory Program. And that's really our next steps, because I wanted to end the talk really with saying, where are we going with it? So this is the Indian River Lagoon Observatory. You'll be hearing a lot more about it in the future. When we first start using this word, a lot of people say, well, what's an observatory? Isn't that something, you know, you go out and you look at the stars? Well, yeah, that's one type of observatory. An environmental observatory, though, is more about monitoring certain types of data. So these are all some of the other examples you may be familiar with. You know, there's observatories for volcanology, for example. You may be familiar with the North Pole Environmental Observatory. It's one that gets some of the most hits. People are really interested in what goes on there at the North Pole. There's a lot of long-term data that's being generated around the world. And basically, that's what we want to do with the lagoon. Because when you have these incidents like blooms, but even when you don't have things like that, you really, to get a better understanding, to get a better idea of long-term changes, This type of approach will allow us a much better way, I think, to not only do science, but then to manage the resource such as seagrasses. So this is really something that we've launched here at Harbor Branch, and it's meant to be long-term, multidisciplinary, so, you know, not just seagrass people, but all the other disciplines, you know, working together. And we really want to focus on emerging issues of environmental health and better understanding of that life that I talked about, biodiversity and ecological functions, and also the piece about how do we all impact the lagoon. And our goal ultimately is to acquire and disseminate data and knowledge that's critical to how the system works and how it can be managed long term. So some key elements I've listed here, but I want to just tell you about three of them, giving you an example. The next thing, one of the next things we're going to do, we have purchased two of these. They're called LOBOs, Land Ocean Biogeochemic Observatories. They're kind of like the equipment that I mentioned to you earlier, except these can stay out in the water a lot longer without having to be pulled in every week. And they also have the capability to do nitrogen and phosphorus chemistry in real time. And they can beam it to us, and any of us can sit wherever we are, here or at home, and you'll be able to see the data essentially real time via the internet. Okay, so there'll be a dedicated website sometime early next year that we will launch with two of these. We're writing a proposal, didn't get funded last year, so we have to write it again to try to get three more. Okay, so that's something we're trying to do. This is part of that observatory approach. Where can you put more sensors out? Can you get more data, and can you get it real time? And can people use these? There's some folks over at Sanibel Captiva that use these. They have about seven of them in the water. Do you know who the biggest users are? Biggest users are people who do remote sensing with satellites because they're trying to ground truth their data. And the other big users are the fishermen, the local fishermen. They'd like to know what's going on in the water. Okay, so I would not be surprised if that's what happens here too. Another key word was multidisciplinary ecosystem based. There's a number of emerging issues that I'm not really going to talk about in any depth at all. And you've heard about some of these before, like some of the issues with the marine mammals. You've heard, I think, Peter McCarthy talk about antibiotic resistance in microbes and some of the microbial issues that are out there. And we're working on some of these cyanobacteria blooms or blue-green algae blooms, another type of alga that's an issue. So these are all things that really one person really can't do, one organization can't do. So more and more you're going to see that we'll be doing this in a very collaborative nature. And so last year, for example, in this room, we had the first of a long-term series, we hope, the Indian River Lagoon Symposium. Our theme for the first year was looking forward, because the theme was restoration, and we looked at wetlands restoration, oyster restoration, things like that. We're going to have one again in upcoming February, and the theme is going to be lagoon health. So it would be really appropriate given all the issues with the blooms and so on. There's a lot of challenges ahead. I don't really probably need to remind everybody, but that's the population of Florida. It has had a brief lull because of the economy. But I'm sure you all know that the projections are that it's going to just continue up. So anything that we do, the more of us that do it, unless we change some of the things we're doing, we may have some issues. And you've heard several other lectures in the series on sea level rise. And we know that sea level rise is going to be a player here. And there's been a lot of events in recent couple of years. People are starting to realize that. And actually, the counties from Indian River County south are working together. It's called 750. If you just Google 750, if you're interested in that, it's seven counties, and they're looking 50 years into the future. And they're basically, there's no regulations involved. It's just getting everybody to work together so that at least the issues are out there, and if people have solutions, that they share them. And it's kind of an interesting thing. So what's my take-home message today? Well, the Indian River Lagoon is a dynamic estuary with much variability in time and space. Human impacts on the lagoon have accumulated over at least 80 years, but I would argue they're still poorly understood. The management of the lagoon is challenging given this dynamic nature and all the pressures from the surrounding watershed. And our knowledge really on how the lagoon works, basic things, is inadequate. And in order to manage the lagoon properly, we require sustained focused scientific research and monitoring. That's where we come in. That's where Harbor Branch comes in. And my little plug is that seagrasses are a critical part of the IRL, its health and its management. Some of the other speakers in the series have done some things that I kind of like and say, you know, I sit through a lot of these and I kind of learn, right? So some of them have said, what can you do sometimes? And I thought, well, maybe I should try that and see how this works. You tell me. One thing is, if you're a boater, responsible boating does protect seagrasses. You should know your local waters. You should study your charts. You should read the waters. Know your depth and your draft. And if you run aground, like this case over here, there's some things you should do. You know, don't keep plowing through the seagrass. Turn your engine off. Walk the boat out. If you run aground, you can walk the boat out. I think another success story in the lagoon was very recently. I came home one night and I was watching the rerun of the county commission in Indian River County, and I saw Paul's here, right? I saw Paul over there, and he was speaking, and I said, I think I know him. And he was basically presenting to the county commission something he had talked to a lot of different people in the area and a lot of the institutions, including Harbor Branch. And he basically said there's this piece of seagrass called the moorings flats, which obviously is by the moorings. And a lot of boaters run around, and he and a bunch of other folks said, we really want to try to stop that. So they put together some money. They got half of the money that was needed. They went to the county commission. They made a really nice case, and the county commission gave them the other half of the money. And so I was really pleased, because as a scientist and just as a citizen, just to see that a bunch of people could get together, and I know how hard they worked, and the county commission actually asked them about how many hours and, you know, how many years it took to do. And you can talk to Paul later if you want, but basically my understanding is the idea is basically to put not buoys that will alert people to the presence of seagrass, and there'll be a lot of educational information. It's really an education project, okay? So I just want to say there's a lot of things that people can do, and here's one. If you're interested in that, Paul, I know, is having an event in the very near future, and maybe when the question and answers are, you can tell us more about that. How about for the pollution issue? Well, fertilize wisely. Hardly any of us need to use certain types of fertilizer. Hardly anybody needs to fertilize with phosphorus, for example. How do you want to find out? You can actually go to the agricultural extension agencies. They're in all the counties. They will test it for you, and they'll tell you if you need phosphorus. And usually you don't. But there's also a lot of other things you can learn about fertilizing. If you have a septic system, I have a septic system. You should keep it in good shape. We want to try to reduce anything that in stormwater runoff. So, you know, it's not a good idea if you're going to fertilize right before it rains. Not only is it a bad idea for the lagoon, it's a bad idea because you're wasting your money, because the fertilizer is just going to go down the canal. So again, this just goes back to the whole state, really, in the southern part of Florida, is channelized. This is the channel from Lake Okeechobee. And my thinking about this is that we're wasting an awful lot of water when we discharge, because it's all just going out in the ocean. And if you look long term, Florida is going to have a big issue with getting good fresh water. So there's a lot of effort by the agencies now to save that water and put it back in the center of the state. Indian River County, again, has done a great job. A big part of the western part of the county is now basically holding water. This is one of the locks, and you've probably seen these around in the area. All canals lead to the lagoon, so, you know, be careful what you put in the lagoon. I referred to this talk earlier. We actually tape our talks, and it's up on YouTube, and I put a little handout over there if you want to look that other talk up that I alluded to, because that talks a little more about the water quality. And also I made copies of those two slides about what you can do if you're interested on either side here. You can pick them up on the way out. A lot of people have contributed over time, either money or guidance, technical support. I've always had great people work with me here at Harbor Branch. And of course, we got to thank Kermit. That's it. So, questions?